So, hi everyone. Let's welcome Sergei Lukyanov from Rutgers University. We'll talk about black holes, sigma models, and integrable spin shapes. Thank you.
All right. First of all, I'd like to thanks for giving this opportunity in the pandemic era to give the in-person talk. It's my pleasure. Okay, so I will talk about some problem which has appeared in study of certain integrable systems, but I think it's of a certain interest in general, well, quantum field physics. So since I'll try to be as far as possible from integrability, let me start with the very basic stuff. One of the surprising discovery in the early days of the development of quantum field theory was the notions the Feynman propagate, right? And this is Green function for, let's say, for plane Gordon equations, but the Green function of such state never appeared in physics before. And among the strange features of this propagator is that can be naturally continued to a complex value of time. That can be seen explicitly if you perform the integrals over P0 component. If you do the integrals when you do the integral rotate the integration contours, it's some standard trick. Then the analytical property of the propagators became quite clear, in particular for the function of t, it was the following structures, right? It have the two branch points. You can make the function single valued by doing the branch cuts in the complex plane of time. And then you see from, let's say, they starting with the space like separation, it's naturally to continue to imaginary times. So this is, of course, in some strange features of the propagators, but it maybe looks rather technical, but in fact, it makes that result many interesting phenomena, and namely, especially it's easy to see if you if you doing the part integral quantization. So consider the sum over the quantum mechanical amplitudes, which is complex number, but performing these weak rotations, the path integrals, after the weak rotation, the convergence of the path integral dramatically improved, right? And as a result, we get something still path integral, of course, but with the when you integrate real positive numbers, right? It makes the practical use of the path integral representations much more convenient. But what we see that in Euclidean versions, right? So after these rotations, weak rotation, we get the systems can interpret this path integral as a certain classical statistical system describing the thermal equilibrium of the classical field. Yeah. Schematically, I just denote this field by phi. Well, and then the energy for the classical field configuration coincide with the Euclidean actions, and the temperature can be identified with the Planck constant. All right, and then we have usual quantum mechanics. We have a certain set of standard conditions like the unitarity, and they all then can be translated in terms of interpreted in terms of the classical statistical system. In fact, that would be the set of conditions which ensuring the thermodynamic stability. All right, among such a condition, for example, that the function that the action should be convex function. Right, so it's a positive. This matrix should be positive there. But in reality, in real physical interesting situation, that this condition can be valid, and it's valid already for the quantum electrodynamics. right? And it, the same happened also in non-abelian gauge theories. But in the subtlety was overcome by using the gauge invariance, right? Already the idea of this was developed in the early early era of the quantum dynamics. But in principle, the, in spite of the actions, it's not strictly speaking, it's not positive, it's not convex functional, but still you can proceed. Similar happened with the string theory, right? But now the rule of gauge invariance plays the reparametrization so invariance of the world sheet. And at least at critical dimensions, like at 26 for bosonic strings and 10 for superstrings, the problem can even starting with the string propagating in the Minkowski in the Minkowski background, where the we have such a problem with the positivity of positivity. We can resolve this problem and go further, at least in critical dimensions. But now I would like to consider the situations, consider the nonlinear so-called the system, which called nonlinear sigma model in two space time dimensions, but with the pseudo-Riemannian target manifold. So this the problem, it looks very similar to the problem which we have in string theory. If you use the Polyakov path integral representations, here, I not assume any reparametrization invariance. I just fix my, I take the wall sheet and fix it forever, right? And they don't use the reparametrization. So I'm not going to use the reparametrization invariance to decouple some degrees of freedom, like how it happened in string theory. So I just consider the theory as it is, as a two-dimensional quantum field theory. And perturbatively, so you can, of course, do with some perturbative calculations, no problem with this. But the questions is it can we define the theory? Can we how to define how to understand the theory when the we clearly have a problem with the path integrals, the convergence of the path integrals. All right, then at this point, you can ask me why we, what's the interest? Why do we need to consider such systems? In principle, the motivations come from, well, the different sources for this, but I think the most interesting one is come from the condensed metaphysics. So among the most prominent physical applications of nonlinear sigma models, in the description of universality class of first transition disordered electronic system. So this is a situation, let's say the quantum Hall effect, integer quantum Hall effect. This is a picture from internet, actually, that some schematically they represent the situation, physical situation, how the resistivity depends on magnetic fields, and also there's some hypothetic fast diagram, which is a sigma x is sigma x y, it's a conductivities, and you can think about the coupling constant, and this picture shows the expected realization group flows, which describe the these transitions, you know, the transition between the different integers values of conductivity. So all right, and when development of such as doing the in attempt to construct the field theory describing such a describe the universality class of such systems, the original one, the perhaps the most straightforward way, try to apply the so-called replica trick, fermionic version of replica trick, and the result it leads to so-called Pruskin model at the beginning of 80s, But it can be understood as a non-linear sigma model. Where n play the roles of replica indexes, so in principle we should set n equal to zero. But it's clear that in such a situations, well, later actually was further development of people try to explain describe the system using another type of using the so-called supersymmetric approach by which developed by Defetov, and formulate the problem in terms of the nonlinear sigma model, but in for the certain superspaces. But anyway, just from physics, it's clear that the requirement that the system, if you have a system with a disorder, then the requirement that the underlying quantum field theory is unitary theory, it may seem too severe, right? And so this way in principle would be interesting, just try to assign the meaning of the quantum field theory, like in the simplest setup. This is the simplest setup for the action. So we have a metric, right? And this metric is has a Minkowski signature. Then this condition would clearly violate the requirement of convexivity. So the path integrals looks it's still defined. Not clear what to do, but still the question is: it principle possible to define the field theory in this case? All right. So let's think. So what can we do in such a situation? But the first which come to once you doing the system with the Lorentzian with the Minkowski signature, the first thing which come to mind is to perform the trick, the same trick as we use for world sheet. So perform the weak rotation. But now, not in a world sheet, but in target space, because our target space has an indefinite metric. So let me, an example which is actually going to discuss today is where it looks rather simple. It's our target space is two dimensional, U and V are coordinate, real coordinate. And the metric looks like this, very simple metric, right? And these metrics appear at the end of ages in the context of string theory, and it was realized by Witten in 91 that this metric possesses all features of black hole geometry in 1+3 dimensions, usual black hole metric in crustal coordinates. So in particular, if you draw the first space-time diagram for this metric, then you see there some specific lines, some specific curve on the UV plane. In particular, the situation when U and either U or V equal to zero, so UV equals zero, it corresponds these axis, right, lines. And similar, like a four-dimensional, three plus one-dimensional black hole. This is not a singularity. It's not physical singularity, it's horizon. It's analog of a horizon usual from 3+1-dimensional black hole. So curvature remains finite at this last. But singularity occurs in the hyperbolas, right? UV equal one when we have singularity of the metric. And this is actually singularity, not just it's not a coordinate singularity, but it's a physical curve, the singularity, curvature became infinite. And then you see the different regions, in particular, in principle, we cannot there is no globally defined time in for this metric, but in each of the domain 1, 2, 3, and 4, you may introduce certain Killing coordinate, right? Which play the roles of time, and the region 1 and 2. It's in this case the Killing vectors time-like, and the 3 and 4 it's space-like. So in principle, the normal observable should be taken somewhere in domain 1, right? And so suppose we are here. So suppose we are in this domain. Then we have a killing coordinate, which is identified with the time. And the idea is perform the Wick rotations to replace this real time, this real coordinate, killing coordinate, by imaginary. Take to the imaginary value. So it means, it just means that we choose the different reality conditions, the different in original matter Q and V were real number, but now we impose certain different reality condition, different section. If you if U and V understood as a complex arbitrary complex now. So the procedure just which I described, it's exactly the same procedure as standard Hertel-Hock analytic continuations. So as I said, we have in this domain the killing coordinate can be identified with the logarithm minus over the V domain. This combination is real, positive real number, so you can take logarithm if you in this domain. And then you continue from real values of T to pure imaginary. So we perform the Wick rotations in this metric. As a result, that leads to certain conditions, like which is now U and V are not real, but they're complex number and related this way. So you the complex conjugate that U taken with the opposite sign gives V. So this is another section. In another reality condition that we start with, and then finally, well, performing such a substitution in this formula and ignoring the overall sign, we get the metric like this. And this metric, of course, U it's a complex numbers now, complex coordinate, but this metric is clearly it's a Euclidean matrix. It's a positive definite metric. It's perfectly well defined. No problem with this. And this is full analog of the Euclidean black hole. If this metric corresponds the Lorentzian black hole LBH, I call it LBH because the because of the Lorentzian signature of the metric, then this metric, which are obtained by the analytical continuations, it's a Euclidean. And once we have performed such a continuations, we may introduce the sigma models. Two sigma models. One of them is Euclidean sigma models. Another one is Lorentzian, right? And as for the first one, then the theory is, looks perfectly well defined. The path integral is perfectly well defined, no problem. In fact, it started since the beginning of 90s. This theory was studied. It was demonstrated that that corresponds to certain conformal field theory. So the theory remains conformal at the quantum level, and the property is well known. It's much known about this model. But now the question is, okay, suppose we know everything. So what can we say about this? The model, which is where the path integral is not defined. And this issue would always arise with if for any two non-linear sigma models related by the Wick rotations in the target matrix. And in general, unfortunately, no reliable resolutions available. So of course, we can even resolve the Euclidean versions. Then it's difficult to say something about the Lorentzian. And what I'm going to talk today is about some progress which was done in for these two models, I will talk about the way how to assign the meaning of all the quantum field theory for this the theory with Minkowski.
With
Lorentzian.
Question.
Yes.
Just to be sure, so the first case, the CFT is some sigma model.
What?
In the first case, the CFT described by SL2 mod U1 coset.
Yes, absolutely. This is that would appear. Yes, this is. In principle, this is a you can start with SL2R versus Zuminovich model, but not compost, right? And the gauge it well, the meaning of this gauge it over the compost you want.
What is the level here?
Level it's more or less the same as a Planck constant, level arbitrary.
The level is arbitrary.
Yes, level is arbitrary. Yes, you of course I will show
okay.
you. The level, of course, if you want, I will denote it by n or some.
Yeah, yeah.
Just well, of course, it's parameters. Yes, of course. But this section. This is a mean of the model.
Yeah, yeah. I know the sigma model. I'm just wondering how does the level show up so far?
Right. In principle, the role of the level, one constant with the coefficient in front of the action. This is a Euclidean black hole.
Yes.
Right. And a Lorentzian black hole. You can start with the same SL2 R. But gauge it over the non-complex.
The non-like you want. Okay.
Right. So in principle, they in the Witton paper they consider both situations. So the actions we are talking about, and they formulate actually the problem in that paper. So that it's not clear what to do, how to understand the theory for this situation, since it's a the path integral formulation is no problem with this, but this one it's much more interesting.
Sure.
That's actually the motivation. The motivation when trying to understand what's written on the written paper. All right. So now, so what should we? How we going to handle such a situation problem? And again, then we have some using some we use some experience from statistical mechanics, right? And in principle, the path integrals, right? If you're doing the path integrals like this. Right, this A is energy for certain two-dimensional statistical systems. But instead of doing this two-dimensional classical statistical system, we can formulate the problem in terms of the one-dimensional quantum changes. The simplest example, the simplest, which is in textbook, I think in many textbook in statistical mechanics, example Heisenberg model. So you have a classical statistical system like an Ising model, but you can formulate it as a quantum one-dimensional spin chain, Ising chain. So you see that makes, in other words, here we're doing the path integral, but if you formulate it as a spin chain, at least we can now address the question. So you have a Hamiltonian, you can diagonalize it and without, at least for the finite chain, we have finite matrix that we can do the explicit calculations, because the path integrals here is not since that may be easy to understand what's going on. So instead of doing the statistical mechanics, classical statistical mechanics, formulate the problem in terms of the one-dimensional quantum spin chains. And exactly in the same these directions, the people start thinking about this problem. In fact, in the context of Pruskinian model, they start try to reformulate the problem in terms of the spin chains. And there are many people, some people, I don't know quite sure about the history, but at least in the preprints of Zirenbauer, it was formulated the statement that the Pruskinian model share the same infrared behavior as a certain class of one-dimensional spin chains whose degrees of freedom take the value in a alternative sequence of the modulus. So you have a spin chain, right? In usual spin chain, let's say like an Eisen's chain or XXZ chain, you have with each side, you associate certain space, right? For example, for the Eisen's chain or XXZ, it's a space, two-dimensional space, space of representations of SL2 algebra, right? This something similar happened here, but for the spin chain, we should take the space V, it's not finite dimensional, it's actually Verma model for the certain super Lie algebra GL22. In the matter of fact, it's actually PSL22. Doesn't matter for us in this point, but it was interesting also that you should consider the spin chain when the representation you put on the side actually alternate each other. So this space V. Another piece, it's a conjugated space. So if you this representation is highest vector model, this is lowest one, and you have a sequence of alternating model. So that is this model is rather complicated because even for just numerical formulation, because in each side you have infinite dimensional spaces. So clearly the problem how to simulate it on the computer. But anyway, that was, and also it was shown that it's not integrable in the usual Barthes sense. It's not bad, but at least it the interest was prompted in the study of integrables, integral critical alternating spin chains. So the situation when you have a critical system, but in each side you have not just the same representation, but alternate. It may be in principle the same, it may be equivalent, right? But not identical, I would say. So that was that some interest, it was some development. It's the people start to think about this problem at the beginning of the 20s. Well, and then some number of works was done in this direction. But the most remarkable output of this study, I would say that the paper of Iklip, Jacobson, and Salor. I will refer to this as IGS. They formulate the conjectures which concern the critical behavior of the so-called alternating spin chain, which is an integrable, because this spin chain occurs from the in the same integrability class of the it's a special type of integrability class of the latest system introduced by Baxter 50 years ago already. In 71, Baxter used the property of the solution of Young-Baxter equation. They introduced a certain multiparametric classical statistical system, which is integrable by construction in certain sense. And this spin chain actually with this. It is some special, he said, the case of the such a mode. So that was a quite surprising, because the model was introduced by Baxter 71, you know, and the people, of course, because everybody heard about the six vertex model, which because it's plays important role in understanding of scaling universality. Usual six vertex model. Homogeneous six vertex model, but it was very little since it's very little known about when homogeneous situation the model the Baxter model when the it's not homogeneous but it's a certain unhomogeneity introduced for the system the critical and only last I would say 15 years. The people start to investigate the situation, what a different type of critical behavior may appear. Well, and that was exactly a result of the study of this critical behavior formulated the Iklip, Jacobson, and Salor formulated the certain conjectures. And here is the conjecture. So this is the paper. And what to say? So the Hamiltonian in this case of alternating integrable alternating spin chain can be bring up to the similarity transformation can be bring to the following form. So for this system we still have the situation when in fact the V and V star now it's equivalent, so they're not still two-dimensional space. So on each side the power just usual Pauli metric sets, and the Hamiltonian looks similar to just the usual Hamiltonian for each success spin chain, contains additional parameter gamma, which is similar to the anisotropic parameter for each success spin chain. And what would be important that gamma belongs to certain domain. The system is critical as gamma from zero to pi, but the regime which we are interested in here, it's when the gamma is restricted by these conditions. And now that the also important, let me draw your attention that this Hamiltonian is not Hermitian because of this I, it's imaginary unit, right? You have these terms actually broke the unitarity, you broke the hermeticity of the Hamiltonian. So if you start to deglobalize this matrix, you immediately see that the spectrum is complex. So this is not Hermitian Hamiltonian. Nevertheless, what they said, that as you increase the number of sides, if you consider the scaling limit, that the scaling behavior of this Hamiltonian would describe this SL2R you want Euclidean black hole. Right? This one. That sounds a little bit confused because we started the system with the non-Hermitian, but this model is clearly Hermitian. Right? So no problem with Hermeticity, unitarity. And but of course you can say, okay, no, that happens. Sometimes it happens, right? Take the quantum electrodynamics and introduce the Pauli-Willis regularization. Immediately broke the unitarity. But unitarity restores and the scaling limit when the parameters when you drop after the regularizations, then the problem disappeared. In principle, that was the author keep this mechanism at mind when you formulate because it's clear. But as a matter of fact, there is also another issues for this conjecture because I'm not going to discuss in whole details. There are some issues, some inconsistency with this formulation, but what is actually was why they still, anyway, they insist that about such a remarkable relation between the spin chain and Euclidean black hole and NLSM, because it was very strong numerical evidence, which you cannot just drop, just ignore. And I will explain what numerical evidences actually what numerical work was performed to make such a conjecture.
Is it important here that the theory that the continuum theory anti-Wiss does not have a normalizable vacuum? You know, therefore, this non-homomorphicity.
What do you mean normalizable vacuum? This is a question. What do you mean normalizable?
So in the spectrum of the CFE associated with the SL2.
Yeah. There is some issues, of course, like in Liouville theory, they can say, but that's normalizable. Yeah, in certain sense.
It's a function below of the operator.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. Clearly, the some problem. But the statement was not about the finite spins. What's important to keep in mind this is a statement about the scaling limit.
No, I understand. I'm saying is that somehow secretly important for the disappearance of this non-unitary in the continuum limit. Are these two things correlated?
Yes. Some. I would. Okay. Let's
just asking for the intuition for why
the intuition is that in principle I would like to say that this conjecture is not quite correct.
Okay,
that's my point.
Okay,
so that is okay. Maybe better to proceed
and further. Also just to be sure, so the gamma will determine the center charge.
Gamma is related to the level it determines the center charge. Yes,
okay.
But yeah, that's another issue because the central charge of this model, strictly in usual understanding, is greater than 2.
Yes.
Right. And that is indeed one of the issues with this identification and the problem.
And that's the central charge of the black hole.
It's a black hole, right. The central charge of the black hole. That what I would like to say actually, the central charge for the theory which appeared in this one would be less than.
Okay.
But anyway, but still, the people, Ablik, Jacobson, and Salor are not so stupid. They're very clever guys. I should say that was a really pro question. All right. Anyway, so what kind of argument they present? They actually based their calculation was based on the work of Maldacena, Aguri, and Son, which they first discussed this model, SL2R U1 model, for in the context of a DSCFT, right, for propagations of strings and these lower dimensional backgrounds. And in particular, among others, they calculate the partition function for this model. And later, the result was reproduced different, very different way by Kanani presence and truth. And that, this result would be important for us. So among others, Maldacena and Agurison calculate the partition function. So what's the partition function? So you put your system on a torus with the modulus tau, and then I said the path integrals well defined. So and so the partition, you have a partition functions, which the partition function depend on tau, on the modulus, and also depend on the Planck constant, right? Which is a basically the level, if you want, relationship to level. Okay, so that is a and what's important, because it's a conformal field theory, it's indeed conformal field theory in the quantum level. So it's a conformal invariant, particularly it's invariant in the set, there's no global anomalies. So it's invariant in the global conformal transformation of the torus. So it's modal invariant function. Right? And but so they present explicit formulas for these partition functions, but the problem. But before I show you the formal, explicit formula, I just like when I said that path integral is well defined, it's not quite correct because actually it contains certain divergence. But certain divergence, but this divergence is well expected. It's arises from the geometry of the target manifold. So what's it, how the target manifold looks like? So so here is the metric, right? And this metric can be embedded in three-dimensional space. It's a simple exercise to show that this two-dimensional metric can be understood as a metric induced on the R3 by the embedding, and the corresponding surfaces looks like this one. It's a famous cigar. Well, it's a Gamilton cigar. Actually, this metric first introduced Gamilton in the study of Ricci flows, the stationary solution of Ricci flow equations. So that is how it looks like. And now clearly we have the domain where U is very small, U in vicinity of zero, then the metric is correspond the tips of the cigars. But if U is very large, absolute value of U very large, then you can ignore one, and as a result you get the flat matrix, and the target manifold resembles the half infinite cylinder. So it looks like very long half infinite cylinder, the infinitely long cylinder in the symplectic domain. And then if you have this picture in mind, geometry, then it, you can immediately predict that the partition function should diverge. Indeed, the main contribution would actually come from infinite cylinder, right? And but the partition functions, so infinite cylinder, it's a, what is this? It's a one compact boson and one non-compact boson, right? In the longitudinal direction, you have a non-compact. It's a non-compact boson field, free boson field, and the compact in transverse directions. And then it's clear that the contribution of the path integral from the asymptotically flat domain would give the singular contributions, which is basically the same as a partition function on infinite torus, infinite cylinder, and some regular part, which describe the integrals, which is describe the contribution or vicinity of the tip. Now, of course, to make the result finite, we need to introduce certain infrared cutoff. We need to, let's say, say that the length of the cylinder is not an infinite but restricted in some ways, right? We introduce the, I will use the one over the epsilon as a regulator, infrared regulator, but this is regulator in the target space, which control the longitudinal size of the cigar. So if you introduce this, if the total length would be order of logarithm one over the epsilon, then the partition function would contain this logarithmic divergence. All right. So now we can immediately say what is the partition functions. So this is a contribution of the non-compact Bose field, which is a correspond to the non-compact directions, and the compact one. So the contribution is you see it's involved the Dedekind function, which is a Q related to the modulus of torus, and the Planck constant. I use the here. You see the instead of Planck constant, I use the letter n, which is level, right? You understand, and it's more convenient. So I use this parameterization. And so n appeared only here, but also for the compact boson, it's also appears more less trivial. For the compact boson, we have a this is a partition function of the compact boson of the free Bose field compactified on the circle. As usual, the contribution from the oscillatoric modes and the terms, the sum can be understood as instanton contributions. Instanton, in a sense, is a classical, it's a solution of classical Euclidean equation of motion, which is very simple. It's just Laplace equations. But it depends, its solution would parameterized by integers V and W. V it's a U1 charge. You have U1 symmetry, and V it's integers U1 charge. And W is a winding number, which just describe how many times the fields wrap around the compact direction when you can make a one turn on the Gauss shift. All right, so this is a partition, so it's divergent part. Now, so here is the formula of Nogdassen algorithm, which we found. So that given by the integrals of the certain domain, domain is a parallelogram. Well, and also some summations in it over the integers, A and B integers, lattice, it belongs to the integer lattice. All right, so N, you see, depend, N again, instead of one constant, or I use the level N, right? And Q, the Dedekind functions already discussed, that it here we what's important when we have a, in denominator, we have a theta one, the standard theta functions, which has zero at z equals zero. So it means that the integral actually diverge. And in order to make the SN, to make it finite, we need to regularize it and to make a hole in the integration domain in the center, exactly in the center where we have a zero of theta functions, right? So we, here we take the certain, we make the hole of the size epsilon, and that makes the integral finite. So that epsilon exactly the epsilon which appear in this regularization, so it can be identified easily, right? So if epsilon goes to zero, it diverges, and the contributions of the divergent part, it's just the partition functions of the on that scene. All right, this is a result from this is exact some formal exact result, and what's important, this is model invariant function. But together with this partition function, they Moldasen Agurison proposed certain discuss the density of state, certain density of state. This theory possesses continuous spectrum, clearly, right? So clearly we have the mode which is propagated along the longitudinal directions, as if I would be understood as a zero mode momentum. Let's consider the instead of doing the all oscillatoric mode, just consider the zero modes. It's called mini superspace approximations, right? We focus on the dynamic of zero modes, then S would be zero mode momentum. If for the cylinder, S can propagate in both into the left, to the right. But once you have the in principle two states with the same momentum, which has the same energy, but if you have a tip of the cigar, then instead the stationary state correspond not just to a plane wave, but the state which is a scattering state, right? So if you start for example with the wave which propagates over the tip, then it would reflect and go back. So the stationary state actually the superposition of the wave which moves back and right and left. Well, and but as I said, to assign the meaning of the theory, we actually need to introduce certain cutoff, right? In other words, we should put the wall at the left of the cylinder. We should cut the infinite part. But once you introduce the cutoff, if you put the certain well, certain restriction reflection condition for the wave, then you immediately get the quantum number S would quantize, because like for the particle moving, well, this formula just has a very simple method. It's just if you have an infinite well potential, then you have quantization conditions And then the spectrum of momentum with the order of some integer divided by L, right? And L in this case is the length of the signal. So we have a, this is very rough approximation, but to be more accurate, we need to take to account the phase shift, which we have to take into account the fact that the particle reflects at the turning point, classical trajectories turning point, and which in quantum level, which result the certain phase shift. And this phase shift can be in superpositions of the phase shift occurred in the tip of cigars and at this four. And what was argued in the Maldacena algorithm that this wall actually should be, they identify this wall with the Luvio. Why they do so, I don't understand. This is a kind of absolutely the argument. I don't understand the argument. They don't even try to explain you this. But anyway, they choose the first shift.
They probably use the tutuality. Oh,
that's your two. Yeah, but you see, but we, you're doing, but let's return to this point. This is extra room. But what they did, they take the tip, the first, the people know everything about the scattering phase of the tip and also know the limit. And they just combine these two phases and find the whole. Let's take a look. It's very beautiful form. And basically, I would say, that was only the argument. And P and P bar, it's exactly this related with winding mode and the winding term. All right, so this is the first shift. And then if you have this first shift, then immediately we have a quantization condition like this. And as usual in quantum mechanics, consider the limit when the size became very large, it leads to the certain density of state. So basically what you need to do is differentiate the density of state would contain divergent part, which is a very simple meaning. It's a trivial because of it, this part just came the same as a particle in the infinite well potential, but also that some contains some non-trivial part, regular part, which is basically it's a derivative of the total phase shift. So that is a function. So that gives they give these expressions. For the phase shift. And what they studied the second class of the primary state of the spin chain in the spin and limit, do the numerics and see that it's exactly follow this, exactly this phase. So this is a result of numerical simulations. They found that increasing, of course, it depends on number of sets, but once you increase the number of sets, then the density of states would exactly follow this curve. And when n now plays the roles of the one of the, you should identify one of the epsilon, which is regulator in the target space, identify with the infrared regulators, but in the wall sheet of the spin chain. But this is very, you see, that is quite impressive such a numerical checks but as we already mentioned that in spite of convincing numerical evidence, proposal raises immediate questions about the unitarity. Already mentions what doing in the unitarity, and there is other issues which I'm not going to discuss, but nevertheless, if you are not simply brush aside this issue, it could be taken as a signal that IGS conjecture is not quite correct. And then immediately possibility occurs that maybe it's correspond with another, just another Euclidean section, in another reality section for the matrix. And actually that was a motivation for our works with Volody Bajanov, Lev Katavus, and Sergei Kavalin, which is good. And we performed some numerical work, what we found then, indeed, we checked that not just for a certain class of state, but it just partition functions. And you see that numerically, indeed, the partition function of the spin chains, half of this partition function coincide with the partition functions of the Maldacena algorithm. But the conjecture, we revised this kind of conjectures. Well, maybe I'll return later, but to this point. So in principle, so indeed, we give some numerical checks and other checks that in the scaling limit or some certain sector of the spin chain would indeed describe the Lorentzian, can be naturally identified with the Hilbert space of Lorentzian black hole. It makes quite interesting this situation because now we have some tools to study, right? Numerical tool, we can study this and do some make some predictions about this thing. Okay, but let me explain how we check this one, this part of this one. What was done? And but first I will need to proceed with the density of state which proposed by Maldacena Aguirre-Sol. And this formula was obtained in a kind of type of mini superspace approximation using the argument for the zero modes. In fact, then the next step, they actually proposed then the density of state. If you now can take into account the oscillatoric mode, then the effect would be if you consider the certain level of L0 bar, it's a conformal field theory. If you have a generator of conformal symmetries, in particular the L0 and L0 bar standard notation, right? If you consider and the eigenvalue of the separators are describe the conformal levels in the conformal towers. So if you consider the excited state with the different levels LL bar, then the density would be the trivial part would be the exactly the same density as for primary state. It is just like these certain combinatoric factors, which is related to which is given inside partition part to L here is the partitions of integer L. So this is a of course it's much more stronger assumptions, but anyway. If you assume that the density of states look like this, then of course you can immediately predict how this continuous state would contribute to the partition functions, right? You take this formula for the density of states, substitute in integrate over the that is the density, then you take and then integrate over the possible value of zero mode momenta, and then sum over the windings and U1 charges. As the result, you, of course, you get some simple formula which involves this fast R0 and the characters of just a free boson, chiral free boson field. So that is a result of contribution. So this is a contribution of continuous states. But the point is, that's not whole story because, as a matter of fact, like in, sometimes happened in quantum mechanics, and together with the continuous spectrum, we have a also discrete spectrum. And this is exactly the situation happened here, that together with the state with the delocalized, which is actually correspond to the scattering state, there is also the states whose wave function, to be more precise, wave functional, localized in the vicinity of the tip, right? And they discuss in literature that some correction was corrected, revised many times, and finally we know how it works. But so I will not discuss it, the discrete component. So, but if you the partition function would be the sum of continuous spectrum contributions and discrete spectrum. But what's important is that discrete spectrum doesn't depend; it's localized. The wave function localized in the vicinity of the tip, so you don't the infrared regulator will not affect on the discrete state. So if we cut the cylinder, but the wave functions of the discrete spectrum is localized in the vicinity of the tip. All right, and so in other words, we if we accept the density of state from Maldacena Aguirre-Sol, then we should have these relations. So we have a partition function which is given this formula, which is a modular invariant partition function, and the contribution of discrete and continuous state. But doing the numerical calculation, you observe that it's not true. It's something wrong. And what happened here? What's wrong? The problem is that this is not true. The density of state, which is described by the mini superspace by the formula like this, it's not actually such a simple. It depends on the level, essentially depends on the level. And what we did, we start with the spin chain and calculate the density of state, not just the primary state, but the density of all the state in the spin chain. Just well, it may be done, for example, doing the starting with the finite chain and consider the well, using the better, you need, of course, to apply the better that's here. But anyway, it's some story. Here, I will not touch it. And what we the result, what we get here, the density from the spin, the density of state from the spin chain, we get the formula, which is looks like. When I write in this way, this is divergent part, it's trivial, but also this one, indeed, it contains the piece from Moldacena-Gurison proposal, but also contains additional factors which depend on LL, essentially. You see, that is some, I will not, don't have a time to display full details, but clearly they're different. And at the poprimary state at the level L equal to L bar equal to zeros, then the factors disappeared and everything is, of course, due to this proposal. And then what you need to do is just to take the contribution of this continuous spectrum, which comes from this density, take to contribution of distance spectrum, again, there's some explicit expression for this, sum this to contribution and compare it to the density, to the partition functions of the plain black hole. And you see that indeed the number is quite good because of course there's some numerical error here because in the summations you need to, well, it's related to the fact that the numerical accuracy of the population. But anyway, so what we see that indeed this density of state reproduced the partition functions of the Euclidean black hole. Well, it's not guaranteed that the density, the partition functions, it's maybe and the density of states contains much more information than the partition functions itself. So, but anyway, it's a good signal that this density of states indeed correct density of state for the black hole, the Euclidean black hole. All right, and just a few words about how we get this result because. Actually, the result for the density of states unreachable by any traditional method. It based on development of so-called ODE-IPFT correspondence. People sometimes use the ODE-IM correspondence. IM means integrable ODE, ordinary differential equations. IM means integrable model. But integrable model. But I would find that the papers of ODE-IM correspondence mostly focus on ODE side, not much discuss the integrable the side of integrable model. And in fact, this correspondence works specifically formulated for certain integrable quantum field for integrable quantum field theory. But for this reason, I use this term ODE-IQFT, integrable quantum field theory correspondence. But anyway, this approach was has already a long time history. It was developed in the mid of 90s, but it's very powerful method, which is actually allows one to investigate the integrable quantum field theory in such details, which is unreachable for any other method. So I use this talk as a propaganda of this approach, but it's indeed very powerful, much more powerful than thermodynamic metallization and other methods that I know for integrity. At least in integrable quantum field. All right, and I'm already to the end of the story. So summary of what is here. So in principle, our conclusion in study of this spin chain, we found that if you start the, if you consider the Gilbert space, which appears in the scaling limit, if you start with low energy spectrum of the spin chain and consider the scaling limit, you get a certain space of states, right? And the system for periodic boundary conditions is important, in fact. For periodic boundary conditions, the system possesses some additional Z2 symmetry, say invariance. Each of the, so the whole Gilbert space split it on two sectors, sigma, the even sector and odd sectors. And so as a linear space, what we said, so what we see from the partition functions as a linear spaces, H plus or minus, it doesn't matter here, right? They is isomorphic as a linear spaces as a as a space of state of Euclidean black hole. So this is the reason why two appeared here. Two is just indicates the splitting on two even an odd component, the contribution idea. But I should emphasize, of course, this is only the statement for the linear structure. But in quantum mechanics, we need not only linear structure, but the Hermitian structure. And this is the main point. And what we said that what we found that if you have if you consider now the it's let's say even sectors, then of course it would split it on two components. You see it on the lattice, which is similar as the black hole. You have a continuous and discrete component, continuous spectrum and discrete spectrum for the spin chain. But our conclusions, our study shows that you cannot simultaneously the Hermitian structures which occurs in these sectors are different. You cannot they cannot think about sigma plus discrete and continuous component. You cannot add them together to interpret them as simultaneously normalizable state of a single CFT. So at this point, you should make a choice. You should choose either continuous or discrete component. And the continuous component, actually, the space of state of the latest systems is can be classified with respect to certain algebra of extended conformal symmetry, so-called W infinity algebra. And this is W infinity algebra, which is also present in this model. But what's important, the central charge for this algebra is less than two. For this model, it's greater than two, but what we see from let's say finite size effect and other one, there's a central charge for the model for the systems here for the system from the latest, the central charge then less than two. And then in fact there is a certain zero vector. So in principle, you can consistently remove all null vectors with respect to W infinity algebra, and as a result get the space, and which we propose to identify with the space of our space for the Lorentzian black hole. So you see the story. So the spaces for this one and that one very similar, but the difference occurs mostly occurred in the different Hermitian structures. That is principle well expected, may be expected from the beginning. All right. So in summary, make a summary. Which is concerned the literature that we indeed confirm that the partition function spin chains simply related to the partition function of Euclidean black hole. We avoid the proposal for the density of states. Actually, we also avoid the statement that the skinet limit of the spin chain governed by the Euclidean point. In spite of this relation, that doesn't mean actually, because this only say something about the linear structure, but not about the Hermitian. And instead of this, we propose make some proposal for the Hilbert space of the Lorentzian black hole. All right, so this is the end of my story. So thank you very much again for all this.
So the lesson that you've learned is the particular of this correspondence between the black hole and this quotient. That's or is it more general in the sense that you said that they didn't identify properly the density of states in this using this?
The statement that you have a models, you have a if you take a general pictures. So you have a Lorentzian and an Euclidean signature. The Euclidean models are usually good, well-defined part integral formulation. Now, and then the question, suppose we know everything about the Euclidean versions. And it looks like the state of states, the Hilbert space should be somehow related, right? Between the Lorentzian, after what for rotation for weak rotations Euclidean in the Minkowski version, it's the same, you know, the for the bullshit, that's Euclidean version of the theory, it's the same, at the same theory, right? It's just a different way to talk about the, you can talk and you can think about the quantum field theory, but instead you can think about the statistical mechanics. It's just a different way to think about the same. But here the story, if you perform the weak rotations in the target space, then the relation is not so simple. And in general, of course, we don't, no general answer, but for this, I think it's one, I don't know any other examples, explicit example where you explicitly can, since you map it to the problem of the spin chain, you can do the numeric, you can indeed investigate the problem in details. That is why this interest. How general the statement? Of course, I cannot comment this. Yes.
So is it a bit surprising that when you restrict to the Z to either sector of the space on this periodic spin chain, that you still have modular invariants? We know that the orbital, if you have some of these equal symmetry.
Wait a minute, the point is there are different, the different Z2 symmetries. Original Z2 symmetries mm-hmm. in the spin chains, original, which is mentioned probably in this. It's not this Z2 symmetry.
Sorry, when you say plus minus, it's not.
Plus the... minus, it's not. There's a point. This actually the problem with the identification, because in the black hole, you don't have such any natural Z2 symmetries.
I know, so that's why you said you restricted.
Yes, and in principle, you see the Z2 symmetry appeared in the fact then in black hole you integrate from zero to plus infinity, mm-hmm. right? Because the state which is propagated to the left and right, they are not. This is a scattering state. It's a mm-hmm. proposition.
I see.
Right. So S greater than, for the spin chain, this quantum number S.
It's just
that can be the sign is well defined, and this is why my original complaint to the for the conjectures IGS conjecture was that actually there is no Z2 symmetry which we explicitly see in the spin right. chain, but right. there is no explicit because this integration come from zero to infinity, and because the state the wave which is propagated in the given direction is not a stationary state.
Yes.
The sign is not well defined. Right. And the integrator, the factor two appears from different, very different story. That's a point. They make mixing of everything.
Yeah.
You know, the different Z2 symmetry, then interpolator statics make some confusion. So,
but can I modify? So you showed that their conjecture must be false. So the spin chain is not described by the Euclidean Sigma model in the continuum limit.
I say that the linear space, the number, the density of state, if as a linear structures,
yeah.
if you take what I said, according what my, that if you take the space of state and choose the even sectors, mm-hmm. that the number of states, density of state for continuous and the discrete spectrum would be exactly the same as the Euclidean black hole in those.
Right.
That because the partition function is the same.
Yes, so the Hermitian structure is different.
But the questions that the Hermitian value is more dense. And they see that we have a double algebra, right? And of course, you classify in terms of irreducible representation. But the point is that the characters of double algebra mostly doesn't depend on central change. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter. Greater than two, smaller than two. And this creates some problem with identification. Because for this one, central charge greater than two, but for the spin chain is less than two, but less than two. But this result actually it required the study the finite size effect, not just some correction, irrelevant corrections mm-hmm. to see what actually the central charge. You cannot just take it. Yeah, I can explain with very simple. What you measured in the latest. What you measured in the lattice, right? So if you just take the Hamiltonian and the finite number of sides, so what you see from numerics, you have some constant. The energy would diverge as a, it's a linear diverge. It's a proportional to the size of the system. It's a trivial, which doesn't depend on state. Then you have the sum factor n, right? And here, if the system is critical, you measure the delta plus delta bar, for example, the scale dimensions of the states, minus C over 24, something like this combination. Mm-hmm. But you cannot measure separately delta and C.
Yes, yes.
And the question is, if you can say, I want to have a C greater than 2, but this is just related for the definition of delta. What you actually can extract from numerical data only this combination. And this creates certain ambiguity and because you're not measuring the correlation function, because strictly speaking, you need to measure the tensor, the correlator of TT, right? So that gives you the central charge in the conformal QP. But here, in doing the numerics, you on the lattice, you may measure this combination. And then what was done in Salor paper, they choose C in such a way that C greater than 2, mm-hmm. but it's changed the delta. But in order to see what is the correct procedure, you need to consider not the adjustment, but also the next order corrections. Then you can indeed say what actually going on, what's the central charge, next order correction. Without this, you cannot actually distinguish.
How does the next order correction depend on C precisely?
Next order?
Yeah. How does the next order term depend on center charge precisely?
Next order term would depend, you see. This is a measure. What is this measure? Basically, what is this? This is eigenvalue of L0 plus L0 bar, right?
Yes.
Which is a Hamiltonian of the CFT, right? This is integrable spin chain. Mm-hmm. And in fact, together with the Hamiltonian, there is another integral of motion. Well, commuting with the Hamiltonian, I will call it E3, for example, which this is usually called E1. Let's say this E3, which is the integrals,
local, and
the integral built out the W fields,
okay,
which is certain operator over product algebra.
Okay.
So you can measure the value of these integrals. And then, of course, the value would depend on how you the central charge. So they give you the all of the corrections, because the corrections goes to, if you do 1/n correction, then the coefficient here would be the value of local and local integral of motion. And since you know how to construct this local and local integral of motion, then you can try to see how to consistently define those. But it's not sufficient to. I just take this structure, integrable structure more became important.
Can I associate this non-hermitian part of the Hamiltonian with Hodgkin radiation?
Good questions. The physics I don't understand. Yeah, it would be interesting to understand how actually it may be interpreted in the context of the black holes physics.
Because if it seems like you put like infinite wall and like all Hawking radiation basically bounce back,
yes,
and you have a stable,
yes, so, but yes, and in principle, right? So you put the wall, but you can put the wall very different way. It's the putting the wall means you put the system in thermostat from statistical point, and how it should interact somehow with the thermostat. And in principle, there are many different ways. You know,
the most natural one is to consider anti-de-Sitter.
but if it depends on it. But here we use that you want the model, the partition function model invert. This is for string theory, it's a reasonable assumption.
Yes.
But for statistical mechanics, it doesn't matter, you know. Why it should be model invariant, it's absolutely not clear, for example. What's this requirement? For string theory, indeed, if you think about the sigma model, if you still would factor out the transfers the non-physical degrees of freedom, then that of course model invariance is important. But as formulated for the spin chains, model invariance. For example, if you change the boundary conditions, right? Mm-hmm. Then it's not model invariant. It's only for periodic bound. So that's the question. So, but you're right. That's of course it's related to this Hawking radiation. So you put in such a wall, you get this very particular thermal state. Mm-hmm. Very particular. This is a very particular density matrix. Because in principle, you can imagine many different types. The only requirement which we learned from Gibbs that the density matrix should compute with the Hamiltonian. So in each level, so it being restricted on the given level, it should be identity matrix. But the coefficients, right? So the only conditions for the thermal density matrix, then the operation, the density matrix compute with the Hamiltonian, right? This is equilibrium condition. In our case, that conformal Hamiltonian. It means that the for each state, the density. So for each level, the metric. If you specify the levels, right, then the density matrix just identity proportional with some cost, but it depends on levels, right? And the way
so you can make it. Integrable system.
This is a certain.
It doesn't thermalize usually. So that's why
this is a little bit different sense. When you're doing a statistic on spin chains, we are not doing the problem of thermalization. We're just doing the find the spectrum. It's a different. We see that you see that if you put the system on a periodic boundary condition. This boundary condition is integrable. And this is certain regularization, infrared regularizations. And it means we impose a certain regularizations way how to in the language of the sigma model. We choose the way how the system interacts with the thermostat. Mm-hmm. And this is very particular integrable regularization. Because you see the principle when you see you have a Hamiltonian, lattice Hamiltonian. Suppose it's an arbitrary system. Suppose it's just a lattice Hamiltonian, just a matrix, right? Mm-hmm. Then you diagonalize it, right?
Yes.
And that's it. And you cannot say anything much more about it. For integrable system, actually, you have many. Are the integrals of motions, right?
Yes.
Q, right? And you can choose the particular state, stationary state, which generalizes all this integral of motion. This is a beta state.
Yes.
And this is a particular, and the commutativity depends on how you, for example, choose the boundary condition. How you, mm-hmm. So any this is very fine tuning for the system, right? So the states actually which you are doing in the integrable system, it's not just a stationary state, it's a beta state. Mm-hmm. Because we can be some degeneracy, you see, the Hamiltonian, but you generalize the Hamiltonian, but they have degeneracy. But if you have operator which commute with the Hamiltonian, you can resolve this degeneracy.
Yes.
And that makes the change, of course, that is important. So what I said that the integrable lattice systems indeed leads to the model invertant partition functions. So and this is rather surprising. In principle, a priori, I would not understand why the regularization partition functions regularizations of Novacen Aguri regularizations should correspond to certain integrable.
Yeah, this is related to what you mentioned that they choose the new wheel.
Yeah, so in principle for the space they choose some new wheel. I don't understand what's going on because it's critical.
I was making this comment, right? There's a particularity for the second model to the sign new wheel. So in that frame, you do have to do
the this model. Is wrong. This absolutely wrong statement.
Right.
Because they probably has the pictures. This is exactly what I would say. Yeah. That
so what is the so you're saying that
I would say
you're saying this is,
if you use this type of argument, this is indeed that maybe should be connected. Mm-hmm. This is the systems Euclidean black hole, right?
Yeah.
So you have this one,
right?
Du, the x u du, minus u, right? And this indeed dual then if you do the t duality in the set,
yeah,
then you can write the sign mu v, which
mean is one a, plus you start
which is a, which is actually like a d phi squared plus d theta squared plus cosine theta phi gamma some gamma phi minus phi beta. If you're talking about it, right?
Yes, yes.
This is indeed the same.
Yes, yes.
Now,
I'm sorry, with the plus sign, with the plus sign, that's important. With the plus sign, the denominator, the first line.
It doesn't matter.
No, no. I mean, just to be sure, what we're talking about, the right thing.
This one.
Sorry. I mean, in the denominator, one plus U star, right?
Yes, of course. Yes, of course.
Okay.
This is geometry. This is not.
Everything is regular.
If you put the squared here, you get. This is one. So this is indeed, and this Planck constant is basically, I would say, the gamma squared minus beta squared is equal to.
That's right.
Right?
So yes.
Right. And this is a summation.
Yes.
And then if you have in mind the regularization.
Yes.
So indeed, the beta goes to this beta goes to plus infinity.
Mm-hmm.
This term disappears. You have a free.
Mm-hmm.
And then the if you have in mind after what you say,
yes,
that you add this here the term like a 2 beta phi,
right,
which is made a thin. This is wrong. This is nothing to do. This is another integrable regularization.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And probably they have in mind such regularizations. What I can, this is my first attempt, but you see this theory,
mm-hmm,
actually correspond to adding to the system. This theory would be equivalent to adding the term like U bar, the mass.
I see.
This is a model which known as Lundrecht model.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And the same, but what I say, what I insist, that these regularizations, the phase shift for model would give. You should actually combine the different terms.
Yes.
Right. This is not true.
Mm-hmm.
But so what? Then I actually they probably meant something different that time, because they say that the alluvial, but it's so they should identify phi with the non-critical alluvial.
That's what I would have thought.
But that was my first understanding.
Exactly.
What they said. A good deception. But this is not.
Okay.
This is what I guarantee.
Okay.
Because you can, for this system, you can write determining the transverse equations, calculate the phase shift. That's not a secret. This is different phase shift.
Right.
It leads to the different situation. Mm-hmm. Right. So that is indeed delicate point. And these regularizations, you see that this regularization creates the gap.
Yes.
The gap in this system.
Yes.
So it's a different. On the latest side, it's a different.
Okay, so let's thank
yeah.
Sergei again.